DJ Payne 1 has some pretty fiery comments for the producer community, so let's open up this video and see what he has to say.
Anyone would love to make music for a living. Unfortunately, there's this incredibly childish narrative that you can either only love music or profit from it, but not both. It's a narrative spread by bitter and jealous musicians who unfortunately...
True, I will say that's a narrative that people tend to use as a crutch because what they're doing is trying to justify why they're not getting results. Because I didn't sell, it's because I'm doing it for the love. But if they're doing it for the love, then they're saying they have to justify why they're not getting results. So they say, I'm not getting results because these other people aren't doing it for the love. They're doing it for money or whatever else. So they have to separate the two. It's like saying, you know, when somebody's rich, it's like, oh, they did bad things to get that. That's the only way they got rich. And then what you're doing is actually repulsing yourself from becoming that because you're using that as a counterculture, a counter identity.
Fortunately, couldn't figure out how to turn their hobbies into careers. And it's also a narrative that I think a lot of people just starting out in the business believe. I worked on music for 10 years before I got my first paid placement. To this day, I give away free beats. If you're a member of my email list, you get free beats from me a couple times a month.
As you should. Let me pause this here.
Passion.
Okay, so he's giving out little nuances that a lot of people are probably skimming over. He said he gives out free beats to the people on his email list. Now, if he values his beats, then and his product and the different things that he creates, then he wants an exchange. He says, what's something valuable to him? Your contact information, because he knows that if you give him your contact information, over time, he's going to add enough value to you to where any transaction or exchange you guys have will be seamless. And when you got, I'm not going to go into a diatribe, but the long story short is when you guys are asking for people's emails, you have to give them something equal or opposite in exchange. And you have to have the value either be equal or supersede what they're exchanging. So for example, if I give you the email to your email list, if you give me something less than, I'm not going to give you my email. If you give me something worth more than I believe my email is worth, then I'll exchange my email. Okay, so you guys got to work on what you give people to sign up to your email list.
Projects without any money up front. I volunteer to teach kids and adults about music business and music production. I love doing this, and I definitely know that those of us who are currently career musicians had to love what we were doing because there are these long periods of time when we're not making a cent, but we're still continuing, we're still persisting, and now we're at a point where
that's the point. I'm not trying to pause every second, but that's the difference between suffering and loving something. Suffering is going through pain, okay? Going through, it means to suffer, okay? Passion means to suffer. I meant to say passion. Passion means to suffer. Following your passion means to suffer. Whereas loving something, there's an equal and opposite exchange. Okay, so in order to do this hard grind that we have to get through, you have to love it because that's the only thing that's going to motivate you to pull you through when there is no reward.
Where we're actually paying our bills and making a living off of doing what we love. And our journey was long, but we're here and we are grateful for being here. But people will make a lot of us, including myself, out to look evil simply because we make a living off of our music. They hate when producers set boundaries for themselves. And I have some very clear boundaries for myself. One, don't lie to me and don't waste my time. I think that's fair. I think that's reasonable. But making music for a living is a dream. It was my dream job and now it's my actual job. And it's amazing. And hopefully I can help more people experience that for themselves. But a lot of people just can't get out of their own way. It starts in the mind.
True.
If you don't feel like you're deserving, or if you feel that getting paid for your talent somehow makes your talent less legitimate, less valid, you've sabotaged your own progress already. A lot of people just don't even think it's possible. A lot of people think...
I think the one thing that people... It's called imposter syndrome. Like if somebody gets a result that they don't believe that they've earned through merit, they tend to sabotage it. So in the beginning of all things, you're going to charge low. You just are because you don't have the belief that you're worth $2,000 until you prove that you've earned transaction over time and earned people their money and earned ROI. It's just going to be very hard. I could tell you all day long, raise your prices, raise your prices, raise your prices, raise your prices. Because prices can go to the sky, whereas prices going down only go down to zero. You can't have a negative price. So going up, you have infinite scalability. Going down, you're limited to zero. And the main thing is I could tell you all day, raise your prices, raise your prices. If you don't have the internal belief and the conviction to raise your prices, it will never happen. So it doesn't matter how much advice we give you. That's the internal battle that you guys are having.
Their music is tainted the second they start making money off of it, and they call everyone a sellout who's actively working as a musician. And a lot of these people aren't making a living off their music, and they feel like nobody else should. This really doesn't happen in other career fields. People aren't showing up to an HVAC office and cussing them out for not installing air conditioners for free. But people are certainly telling producers to work for free.
I think,
in fact,
with his point, the main difference here is that the HVAC company, they have supplies, that physical goods, that actual hard cost. You know, you have labor, actual hard cost, which labor in music production as well. But with things that are more physical, you could see it. I think with creative stuff like music production, for example, because it's so ethereal and you cannot see it, people don't put a tangible physical value to it because it's not physical. That's why the music video was so important. Not just the song, but the music video. That's why all these tangible things like live events, bands, the physical tangible stuff, CDs, vinyls, that's what added the perceived value to music. And I think that's what's missing from most of everybody's marketing offers, is that we're not adding that tangible, what is the value of my thing to your sales.
People are calling producers evil and sellouts for not working for free. And I know damn well that the very people calling producers greedy for not working for free are certainly not showing up to their 9-to-5s and accepting $0 paychecks. Everyone deserves to make a living. That's my stance. So I had another tweet.
I think also too, music is seen as collaborative. So when you can send somebody a file and they can be collaborative and you can both make money on the tail end, they look at it as, why are you taxing me when we can both make money together? That's their mentality coming in. And so you're going to deal with a lot of that with artists who believe that it's similar to, like, you wouldn't pay a producer to collab, or would you? I don't know. Some people would, some people wouldn't. You wouldn't pay a songwriter to make a song, or would you? Okay, so that's that question of, should these artists pay producers now to then get their beats, to then make the song that they're going to make eventually together anyway? And we have to look at it from all angles.
Another tweet go viral. And in this tweet, I spoke on a situation that comes up a lot, and I've made videos about this before. This one in particular got a pretty mixed response, so this content just writes itself. A gentleman reached out to me. He responded to an advertisement, a beat ad that I was running on Instagram. He asked me about a particular beat that I was advertising. Now, I pay for these ads. I pay, you know, I don't know how much, hundreds, thousands of dollars a month to run these ads. He asked me about a particular beat. He said, hey, can we work together on the Ross track with the hook? Now, this isn't just my beat. It has Federo on a hook, so it's a collab. And you know, obviously Federo has to get his money because he put in his work. But I was willing to cut the price in more than half for this guy because he reached out. Look, I'm not a jerk. I want to work with artists, and I want to make my beats accessible. I want to make them affordable for artists. But I also like being direct and honest in my business. So I'm not here to manage people's emotions. I'm not here to waste anybody's time. Let's just figure out how we can make this work. That's my mentality in these types of interactions. But then this guy offered me a deal. I give him my beats for free, and in exchange, he gives me 100% of his distribution royalty.
I got to run that back because it said, how about this? I give you 100% profit of the song for the exchange network with you. I respect your work. I can send the DistroKid information, send you direct access to that song. So I think what the artist is trying to negotiate is, give me the beat for free. We'll make a song together, and I'll give you the back end, whatever that means. So let's break some illusions here. Firstly, if you think about your beats as real estate, this is the equivalent of somebody coming up to you and saying, hey, give me your house. I'm going to throw parties in it every week. I'm going to build this business around your house, and I'll cut you in on 20% of the profit from the parties. And then you can have the house back if you want, or I could just keep the house. Doesn't that sound insane? Nobody would ever do that in real life. But because music isn't seen as an asset, a tangible thing, because people don't add the perception that it is that thing, people treat it as if it's just this ethereal idea still, this ideation. And then you attract folks like this, for example. And I'm not bashing the person who came to him with the offer. I mean, try rather than not try. It's just, as a producer, this is the battle that you guys are going to have, is do you give up the beat for free in exchange for the back end, whatever that means? Now, let's just say the artist was popping and they had a potential. Think about your beats like seeds, or like even real estate, if you want to take it that far. Are you going to give away your house for free in the hopes that somebody can raise the value of that house? If the answer is no, then you need to take that house and rent it out and get that monthly recurring rent, because it's guaranteed you're going to earn the money back for that thing anyway. That's licensing, that's beat licensing, et cetera, et cetera. Now, if you give that beat to somebody, the house to somebody, and they run it into the ground, it's up to you to recover that loss of time, the loss of marketing that you could have done, and all the loss of profit that you could have had. And let's just say the artist, again, is popping. That's the equivalent of you giving your house to somebody and they build a business around it, and they sublease, or they build a business around it for partying, whatever the business is, the baking company, whatever, out of your house, and then flip it into a more valuable asset. They do work to it to raise the value. In that case, that's a partnership, because they're going to be raising the value of your asset. And you have to, the same way you don't just like become girlfriend and boyfriend with random people, you wouldn't do the same thing here. So this person is asking, I've never met you before. You've never learned anything about me. You've never trusted me before in your life, but I would like to be your boyfriend / girlfriend. That's the equivalent of what this guy is saying, but in music industry terms, or music business terms, I'll say. And that requires an extreme amount of trust that he hasn't earned yet. Okay. And you really need to get the word deserve out of your head. Deserve means to earn through merit. It doesn't mean that it's given or entitled. You really need to redefine deserve for yourself, because a lot of people are entitled and they think free, they deserve things.
And in exchange, he gives me 100% of his distribution royalties from streaming. Now, the distributor collects master royalties, which accounts for about 56% of what a streaming royalty pays in total, which is roughly 0.0035 cents per stream. So when someone makes you this kind of offer, you have to weigh your options. I weighed my options by checking out how many streams he had on Spotify. Unfortunately, he had fewer than 300 monthly listeners. So if that's his average across all platforms,
this is like stocks, right? And there's, let's say you're buying a stock at 0.0001, okay? Now, this person can't even get their stock value to 0.0002. Like, they can't even raise it just a little decimal point, okay? Let alone hundreds of points. And who's going to invest in that penny stock that's not moving?
And this is a generous estimate. This is a very liberal estimate. He's making about $5 a month off of his entire catalog total. And so he would be paying me about 1/20th of that. Sounds like a good deal to you? No, of course not. And if you said yes, you also hate being treated with respect.
The only caveat I could think of in this case is that, what is DJ Payne 1 actually losing by giving the guy a free license? That's the part of this argument that I'm missing. I want to know DJ Payne 1's thoughts on this. I'm missing the part as to why can't he just give out the free license and then the guy monetize it and then add DJ Payne 1 as a collaborator, whatever it is, through their distributor. That part, because there's no cost. Technically, there's a cost to the loss of sale, but I mean, again, if he's not buying it, he's not buying it regardless. So you didn't really lose much. So I'm confused as to, is the guy asking for exclusive rights or what? Maybe I'm missing something here.
And you offer them a baseball card in exchange for that car. Do you expect them to look up the value of that baseball card? Of course you do. That's what I did.
Because think about it. There are people who steal beats and don't pay for them and put them up on distributors. I'd rather somebody at least credit me and tie the little pennies that they get from the streams back to BusyWorks beats than to just steal it outright and never credit me. Maybe I'm missing something out of his argument, but
he was offering, saw that it was pretty much zero. Of course, people said I could have been nicer, should have been nicer. Maybe these people are saints in real life who take disrespect with a big smile. I gave the guy an explanation as to why I said no. I wasn't rude. I didn't insult him. In fact, he insulted me by reaching out to me with this business proposition that, from my perspective, was a finesse. A lot of people are like, well, maybe he didn't know better. You know better, because you know exactly how much money you're not making when you log into your distributor account. You know, goddamn.
You never know. He could have been making 50 cents yesterday and make 20 million tomorrow. But that's the lottery mentality that these guys are taught, is that one song, one beat, one thing is going to just transform everything overnight. And that's the lie you guys are taught about the music industry. And I have a whole series exposing the music industry about how you're always taught one thing is this magical pill to transform you from a dweeb into a hero. And that's just the liar being sold. And, you know, so that's,
damn well, you're making $0. So when you go around offering people equity deals, knowing that they're getting a percentage of zero, there's really no way you can say, well, I didn't know. I thought I was making millions of dollars. Come on. Now back to the original premise of this video. Producers hate getting paid. They must. I don't know, because there was an echo chamber of producers telling me I was wrong for not working for free. This guy, I think you pronounce his name, Q the Scientist, I don't know. Too busy looking at numbers, listeners, and followers. Shaking my head, wow, not what could be, but listeners and followers.
That's the mentality. It says, too busy look, this is from Q the Scientist. Too busy looking at numbers slash listeners and followers. Shaking my head, wow, not what could be, in quotes, but listeners and followers. This era of music is a joke. Luckily, I love doing it though. I see where Q the Scientist is coming from. He's saying that why don't people just do it for the love anymore? Why is it a business transaction every time they want to collab with somebody? I get that side of the argument, but I think, I don't know if this is in reply because I don't see in reply to anybody. So I don't see that part of this tweet. But if this were in reply to the DJ One scenario, then I could see where DJ Payne One is saying that he's just asking for a return on his time and his effort. It's not really about these other different things. It's just common sense business stuff. Now, I think, I don't know if this is taken out of context or what. It doesn't seem like I see a reply here. That's why I'm a little confused. But yeah, I think a lot of folks are also sold the dream. Just going back to Q the Scientist, I think also people are sold the dream in the music industry is that stuff could be. It's like looking at all the facts on the table. This artist, unless they change dramatic things about themselves, they're never going to get to these high levels they want to get to. Because they're not doing the marketing stuff. They're not doing all this other stuff that makes the business work. And just by the numbers and by the papers and by the law of odds and averages, it's not going to work no matter what they do unless they change something dramatically about themselves. So I can see both sides of the equation, which is, yes, I do believe people should just believe in the sound and want to collab with people who they think they can make beauty with. Because if you look up the definition of music, it means to create beauty through voice and instruments. Okay, so if my goal is to create beauty, I'm going to be working with whoever I think has that thing to make the best art that we can create. That's what I think Q the Scientist is talking about. I also understand the businessman perspective, which is if I'm selling beats, it doesn't mean that I'm just going to be taking chances on random people just because they don't have followers. That's not the reason why I'm not doing it. It's they don't have any traction for me to believe in. There's nothing to show proof that they can actually do what they claim to do. Now, again, it's that side of it where it's like, okay, but if they're fire and I want to use them as a use case or proof in my portfolio, then I'll take the time to invest in this person. Like a 21 Savage for Metro Boomin, for example. Then we'll build up and kind of build our own thing. But also in order to do that, you have to have trust that that person's going to stay loyal and all these other things. It's more than just, are they good? So I can see both sides of the argument in this case. Again, I don't know if this is just a tweet he saw or what.
This era of music is a joke. Yeah. So he's saying I should have just worked for free because this guy has potential. He obviously has no idea what this guy sounds like. This guy, Son of a Morning Star, says it seems smart enough to me. So he's saying it seems like a good deal, but I didn't give it a chance to grow because what he's.
Okay, I see the little. Okay, I see where it could be a reply. I just realized with that little. There's like a little dash above the picture that I think shows it the right. Okay, so from Sanova. Son of a Morning Star, he says, seems smart enough to me. Don't even give it a chance to grow because your intelligence is so superior, you might miss the biggest opportunity of your life. Wait, seems smart enough to me. Oh, don't even give it a chance. I mean, everybody has a different risk tolerance. You have to remember, like, billionaires are not going to take a risk on the latest thing, okay? Because they're not going to risk their billions over something that may or may not work. Whereas somebody who has no capital, no money saved up, they're going to take all the risk because they need their money to go from $1 to $1,000. So they're willing to take that crazy risk for that dramatic change. A billionaire just needs 10% on the money. They're going to stay conservative because they're just trying to grow slowly over time. They're not trying to grow dramatically to make up for all the eras and decades that they weren't making money. Whereas poor people who came from nothing are trying to catch up on all this time that they missed out in the market. And they want these 8,000% returns every year, which is insane. Okay, so I think the same mindset with music is people are truly expecting every artist in the world to be good. And that's not the case. Just look at the law of averages, look at numbers, look at business principles. I don't buy every business. If I were to buy a business, it has to have X, Y, and Z mapped out. It has to have this much revenue. It has to have this many customers. It has to have this much reach. If it doesn't have those things, what are we talking about? If the business has one customer and it's a great idea, the idea has proven that it's not a good idea because people aren't attracted to it. So there's certain things in business that are just staples in how you evaluate a company.
Telling me is that I believe my intelligence is so superior that I'm missing the biggest opportunity, misspelled, of my life. So I'm so much smarter than him that not only can I spell opportunity correctly, but I can also discern between a good and a bad opportunity. However, in reality, I'm stupid for not taking this deal, because what if this guy's song just blows up tomorrow and it's to my beat and I just missed out? Shit. There is this fear.
I think, the video goes on and, for a little bit longer. So we're going to pause it here. But ultimately, I think, let me just answer the hard question. Should you give away free beats? It's up to you. How much product you give away. Now, keep in mind, the drug dealers out there who gave away free product and samples, they did it because they couldn't advertise on billboards unless they were like, whatever. So my point is, they had to give away free samples. The point of the free sample is to get somebody hooked until they start paying. You don't just keep giving away free samples over and over and over. You give away free samples until you're known on that block, for example, using all the stories from, what's the one in Baltimore? Somebody in the chat helped me out. I forget this. The show from Baltimore, The Wire. Okay, a Breaking Bad. You give away the sample, the person likes it or whatever, they become addicted, then you have customers coming back. You don't constantly give out the free sample over and over and over. Or you have a lot of people who give away all their product and they have nothing to sell. So you have to have it to where you have a set aside amount of things to give away and you are okay with losing that thing and all the money associated with. That's called a loss leader. You take that thing, you give it away, but you're trying to get the attention over to the things that people can pay for. And that's what most producers are not doing. They're giving away all their stuff without any end game. They're just giving it everything away. And then they're expected to give all their stuff away. And then you upset your audience when you don't give stuff away. So you're creating a trap for yourself. I could think of dating analogies, and I'm sure you guys could think of better ones than me. So, and lastly, lastly, the equity conversation from DJ Payne 1. Should you believe in every artist in the world and give them your stuff for free and the chance that they can monetize on the back end? I'll tell you, the back end of the music industry is abysmal. And even if you did get the back end on a poppin' artist, it's hard enough to get your money back. So let alone a small artist. So be smart out there. Look at the numbers. Streaming rates of 0.003 on Spotify per stream. That you're going to take 300 streams to get a dollar? Come on, y'all. How many streams would you need to get your money back? Be smart. Invest in people who you believe in. Instead of trying to get the money right away, work with artists that you can use to prove your concept, your hypothesis. So if you say you're the hardest new jazz producer, find a new jazz artist, work with them, build them up as proof. And then you use that artist as a showcase for all your beats. And then now you're going to attract all the other people who want to make that type of music. That's how I would do it. And that's how I would use free. Okay. Peace out, guys. Go subscribe to DJ Payne 1. Peace.